Thank you. So I thank the organizers for inviting me to give a talk in this beautiful conference. And of course, I wish a happy birthday to Maxime. So I consider a smooth, productive, complex variety. And I recall several definitions which make X more or less like a projective space. So X is said to be rational if it is birationally equivalent to projective space. Then there are several weakenings of the definition. One can say that X is stably rational if X cross PR is rational for some R. And the last definition, of course, we are farther and farther from the projective space itself. X is unirational if there exists a rational dominating map from some projective space to X. Well, of course, here we just want the map to be surjective after desingulation. So, of course, the capital N can be chosen equal to the dimension of X, if you like. Okay, but that does not help very much. So, what is obvious from the definition is that we have these implications that rational implies stably rational, and this implies unirational. But well, if the dimension of X is non greater than 2, then the three notions are equivalent. And in fact, this is equivalent to X being rationally connected. So rationally connected, that means that for any two points in X, you have a rational curve in X passing through the two points. So in dimension 2, it's not so easy, but it's classical, it's a Castelnuovo theorem. But starting from dimension 3, it's not true anymore. So in fact, the three implications are strict. No three, two. And this is known since the 70s. So I recall in the 70s, three groups of people found examples of unirational or stably rational varieties which are not rational. So I recall the kind of method which have been used. So the first one was due to Clements Griffiths. So they produce the examples of unirational and non-rational trifolds. In fact, the examples are very simple. They are the smooth cubic hypersurfaces in P4. What is interesting is not the examples, but the criterion. Their criterion. It's very nice, but very much inside the algebraic geometry. So you consider the so-called intermediate Jacobian. G of X, it's something which is very similar to the Jacobian of a curve. You just have to know that if you have an X which is like this, for example, rationally connected or unirational, then it has H3 0 of X equal to 0. And so you consider the Hodge decomposition on the H3 of X, C. It has only two pieces, as it will be the case of the H1 of a curve. And the intermediate Jacobian G of X, so this is a complex torus which is defined as H12 of X over, so you take the quotient of this complex vector space by integral cohomology of X. So this is just the definition as a complex torus, but it turns out that this is more precisely a principally polarized abelian variety because you can use the unimodular intersection pairing on this lattice. Okay, and with these two data, this object becomes PPAV, that is a principally polarized abelian variety. And the criterion of Griffiths, Clements and Griffiths, says that if X is rational, then as a principally polarized abelian variety, the intermediate Jacobian has to be the direct sum, the product of Jacobians of curves. So, so this is the first method. The second method is due to Iskowski and Manin. In fact, in some sense, it is much simpler to state. They consider the group of birational automorphisms of X. Okay. And they exhibit some trifolds. In fact, the examples are typical examples are the smooth quartic hypersurfaces in P4, for which this group is very small. For example, examples where this group is finite, or even trivial. And then, of course, the X cannot be rational, because otherwise it's a birational automorphism group will be the Cremona group, which is very, very big. Okay. So these two methods, they do not apply to prove, to disprove stable rationality. They work, the Clements-Griffiths method, it works only in dimension 3 because of this unimodular intersection pairing that we use. And the Iskowski-Manin method, maybe with some progress in birational geometry, it could also attack stable rationality. But I have never seen this done. And the third method, to the contrary, which is due to Artin and Mumford, it addresses the stable rationality. In fact, what they do is that they produce the so-called Artin-Mumford invariant, which is this is a topological invariant, which is simply the torsion of H3 of XZ. Okay. So, of course, here the X is considered as a complex manifold, which this is a Betti cohomology. They consider this torsion, and they say, in fact, this is quite easy, that this group, this is a group which is invariant under a stable rational equivalence. By which I mean that, so I will say that X and Y are stably rationally equivalent if X cross PR is birational to Y cross PS for some. R S. Okay. So to see that this is that this, so that this group is well satisfies this property, this invariance property. Well, essentially, you have to prove that it is invariant under the operation which X as a maps to X cross PR. And that is obvious because when you do this, the way the H3 changes, that you just add a copy of H1 of XZ. But H1 of XZ, it never has any torsion. So that's why it is invariant under this operation of taking product with X. And finally, the second operation for which we have to prove invariance is, of course, birational invariant. And now, if you have an X and an Y, which are birationally equivalent, then you will say that here you there is an X prime, which is obtained from X. So you just use a disintegration of the resolution of indeterminacy to say that here you can blow up your X to get an X prime, which here dominates. Here, this is a true morphism. And because the map is birational, it has to be a morphism of degree one. Okay. And then here you, this is just a sequence of blow up. And now on the blow up, the torsion of H3 of XZ does not change. Because again, we know very well what happens under blow up. The H3 changes, but they are just by adding some copies of the H1 of the locus that you are blowing up. So, basically, it's this. Okay. But this has no torsion. So, there is no change under blow up. And then the point is that here this map is has degree one. So the H3 of YZ by pullback maps inductively to the H3 of X prime Z. And so because of this, you conclude that if H3 of XZ has no torsion, H3 of YZ has no torsion. More generally, you prove that the torsion of H3 of XZ and the torsion of H3 of YZ are equal. Okay, I will come back to the examples which have been considered by Artin and Mumford. They are quite tricky. And in fact, the problem is that their method is very beautiful, but it applies to very few cases because it's hard to construct, for example, Fano trifolds. Which have a non-trivial such invariant. So I should mention that there have been some generalizations of this Artin-Mumford invariant in kind of a higher degree generalization, which have been constructed by Colliot-Hélène and Aujangeron. And the generalization is that takes the form of what they call unramified cohomology with a torsion coefficient. And the proof is these groups are invariant under stable birational equivalence. For example, this group, the torsion of H3 of XZ, for this kind of varieties, for example, rationally connected, this is the same as the second unramified cohomology group. So, of course, it's not, for example, if X is rationally connected, or for example, unirational. Okay, and then, so they use these groups in a higher degree, in particular for I equal 3, but it works in higher dimension. So these groups, they vanish for I bigger than the dimension. Okay. So for dimension 3, you will have only the H3, which could work. But I proved that, well, it's not completely correct. I should say that Coriolanus and myself prove that this group vanishes when dimension of X is a tree and X are rationally connected. So that means that this higher invariants they do not apply in dimension tree. So what I'm going to talk about is a new stable birational invariant which applies to rather simple Fano trifolds, for example the so-called quartic double solids, which are rather close to the cubic trifold. So the invariant is contained in the following definition. I say that X admits cohomological decomposition of the diagonal. If my X will have a dimension n again, if I can write so I consider the cohomology class of the cohomology class of the diagonal of X, so it's something which lies in the degree 2n cohomology of X cross X. And I want to write it as a sum of X cross a point of X, so I choose any point, plus another class. And now I want to see another cycle class map. But the key point is that I want that this Z, so this is a codimension N cycle, of course, in X cross X, so what we call a cycle, it's just a combination of codimension n subvarieties affected with integral coefficients. But the properties, main property is that this cycle Z is supported via the first projection onto over a proper closed algebraic subset of X. Okay. Well, so here I just give the cohomological decomposition of the diagonal. If I want to go further, and this is what I wrote in my summary, but maybe I want to insist here on that. I may want to have such a decomposition not at the level of cohomology classes, but in the Chow group of X cross X, and that gives me, of course, a stronger invariant. Okay, so a point which is not very hard to show that. Having the property of having a cohomological decomposition of the diagonal is stable birational. Stably birationally invariant. Property. Okay. And of course, it is satisfied by a projective space. So the varieties which are stably birational should satisfy this condition. Okay. There are two things that I want to say. First of all, there is a remark. I am not going to prove this right now, but it's a general fact which goes back to a paper by Bloch and Srinivas. So I think it's something like this. For example, X is rationally connected, but this applies more generally to an X which has a trivial CH0 group, that is, all points are rationally equivalent in X. Or maybe. There exists such a decomposition of the diagonal, but with rational coefficients here. That is, the cycle you will get here, it will be a cycle with a Q coefficient. I mentioned this to say that the contents of the definition is that the fact we work with Z coefficient, which is not surprising because, for example, we want to apply this to varieties which are unirational, so the invariants that we want, essentially, there should be torsion invariants. Okay, so the second point is that this invariant, in fact, contains, in particular, the Artin Mumford invariant. So maybe I'll prove that because that will be the only proof I will give, and also because it permits to understand very well the contents of the definition. So the lemma is that. If X admits a decomposition of the diagonal, a cohomological decomposition of the diagonal, then its Artin Mumford invariant is trivial. So maybe I explain why this is true. So you have this decomposition that which says that the class of the diagonal decomposes as this sum, and you know that your Z has to be supported on a product like this. Now the D, in fact, you see easily that you can choose the disingulation of. Or maybe up to enlarging your D in case that exists. So here I choose the disingulation of my D, okay, in such a way that the cycle Z lifts to a cycle in a detailed cross X. There is a small subtlety here because, if there might be components of the Z which are contained in the non-normal locus of D, but that's not really a serious issue. So we have this, and then. So I have my Z tilde. Now the important point is that the Z tilde is smooth. And so the reason I did that is that now the Z tile has a cohomology class in H2n minus 2 of Z tile cross X. Okay. And now all these cohomology classes, which are cohomology classes on a product, they act on a cohomology. So if you have a gamma, for example, in H2n of X cross X, Z, it will provide a gamma per star from a cohomology of AX to cohomology of X with Z coefficient, simply defined by a gamma per star of alpha, is first projection, push forward by the first projection of PR2 per star of alpha. And here you take a cup product with gamma, etc., etc. And similarly with classes supported on detailed cross X. And now we have this equality here that can be written as delta X equal to X cross X plus detailed identity of X lower star of the class of z-tiled, which is this one, okay. And you let all these classes acting on the cohomology of X, and you get, of course, the diagonal, it acts as an identity. So here I take any alpha in H, in the cohomology of X. I will assume that the degree is strictly positive. So in that case, so this one, this applied to alpha will give zero plus, and this is easy to see that this is when I let this act on the class alpha, I get simply g tilde lower star of here I have g tilde upper star of the class alpha. So this is an equality in okay. Now the point is that now if I take alpha to be a class of degree 3, and which is of torsion, this class here will be so if now I take degree 3, this one will be of degree 1. And now, if it is of torsion, then I get a degree 1 cohomology class, which is of torsion on detail, and as I used several times, it has to be 0. Okay. And so the conclusion, it has to be 0. And I conclude that any torsion degree 3 cohomology class has to be 0, admitting once I have this decomposition of the diagonal. Okay, and now here is the result. So the result is that there are indeed the trifolds, rather simple trifolds, which are unirational, which have a trivial Artin-Mumford invariant, but which are not stably rational because they do not have this. What is it? Okay, so the result is this. So let X be let Y be very general, K nodal, quartique de Basse-Aline. Si vous êtes quai, c'est le même critère dans la Cévennes. Of course, it's singular, but I consider the singularization of why. For example, by blowing up the note. Then, X does not admit cohomological decomposition of diagonal. And so, in particular, X is not stably rational. On the other hand, there's a trifold. So, unirational, it's very classical. And in fact, it's extremely easy once the X, your X has a node, maybe a little more difficult when a Y has a node. When a Y is smooth, maybe it's a little more difficult, but it's classical. And also what is known is that these X, they have a trivial Artin-Mumford invariant. Okay, so this gives a new way of of proving stable irrationality for unirational trifolds. So I have to explain what are these varieties and why I choose.
So the intermediate Jacobian is three-dimensional.
That's why. I should say that the dimension of the intermediate Jacobian depends very much on the number of nodes. So that's why, if there are zero nodes, it is ten-dimensional. And now the nodes are in general position. So each time I impose a node, the dimension of the intermediate Jacobian goes down. And so that's why I go up to seven nodes, because in that case the intermediate Jacobian has dimension three, and because it has dimension three, it is always the Jacobian of a curve, because any principally polarized abelian variety for dimension three is the Jacobian of a curve. So in that, for k equal to seven, the particularity is that even the Clemens-Griffiths criterion does not apply, and so it was not even known before that these varieties are irrational. Of course, maybe it's more difficult to prove that they are stably irrational, but even irrationality was not known for k equal to 7. For k smaller than 7, I think that presumably, with some effort, maybe it has been done. You can apply the Clemens-Griffiths method by looking at the intermediate Jacobian. In fact, for zero knots, the irrationality was known by the study of the intermediate Jacobian. So what is a quartic double solid? Simply you start from P3 and you choose a polynomial of the homogeneous of the degree 4. Okay. And the quartic double solid is the double cover of P3, exactly ramified along this defined K3 surface. So So I allow nodes to this K3 surface, that is ordinary quadratic singularities. And so that means that the equation of the local equation of your y is basically y squared is equal to f of x0 x3. Well, this is a global equation if you take a coordinate in a convenient space of weighted homogeneous coordinates. So, and of course, if you allow ordinary quadratic singularities for the K3 surface, then because you just had added this term to the equation, you will get ordinary quadratic singularities for your y. And this is what I do, allowing up to k naught.
And then you take small resolutions?
And then any resolution will work, because I mentioned that there are birational invariants, even stable birational invariants. But it's true that, of course, in that case, because I have ordinary quadratic singularities, maybe the best is to take just desingularization by blow-up. The small resolution, it's not algebraic in general, so we prefer not to use it when it does not exist in the algebraic geometry context, in the projective geometry context. So, I put a very general here. Well, if I fix the number of nodes, there is, if k is equal to zero, you just take any polynomial of degree, homogeneous polynomial of degree 4, for example, defining a smooth surface. And in general, we consider the variety of such equations such that the K3 surface admits k nodes. And this is a subvariety of this big space. Okay, so this is a big parameter space. So when you want to impose nodes, you will get something like this, which is a locally closed subvariety. And when I say very general, I mean that inside this, so this is a parameter space. I mean that the result is true for a point in this parameter space, which is taken outside the countable union of proper closed algebraic subsets of the parameter space. Okay. Why did I choose this example? It's very simple. The Artin-Mumford examples, they are more or less of the same form, but with more nodes. So they are exactly quartic double solids with 10 nodes. And it is very important, of course, that the 10 nodes are in a very special position. The point is that well, you impose a certain number of nodes, and then you have the central fiber, and then you desingularize it. And the topology of the central fiber, it won't depend only on the number of nodes. It will depend also on the position of the vanishing cycles associated to the nodes. This is exactly as in the curve case. It is clear that the central fiber of all Lechet degeneration, its topology, it does not depend only on the number of nodes, it depends on other data. And the novelty in the three-dimensional case is that by this very special construction, they can achieve that the desingularized central fiber has some torsion in its cohomology of the great tree, which is really the new phenomenon.
Does this give a structure of a conic bundle?
I think that it's obvious when there is a node, because you just you consider the lines through the node, and the curves upstairs are just conics.
So the answer is yes.
Yes. No, I mean, this is simply because you consider the lines in P3 going through the node. And then they intersect the quartic along only two extra points. And now we consider our equation is like this. So now over each of these lines, you will get something which will be ramified over four points. But here, it's in singularity. So in fact, we will get only two ramification points. So in the inverse image will be a rational curve. This is because there is this node. Otherwise, I don't believe there is a conic bundle structure. And in fact, the proof of this theorem. So this theorem is a consequence, an immediate application of degeneration argument. Which is the following. So let so now I consider the family, the smooth projective. No, so sorry, it's a projective morphism. And B will be a smooth curve. And I assume that the general fiber is smooth, and the central fiber X0 has ordinary quadratic singularities. So what I call knots. Okay. And the result is as follows. If the general fiber XB admits cohomological decomposition of diagonal, and there is an extra condition that I want that the even degree, well. So now what I call X0 tilde, for example, that will be a desingularization of X0 obtained by blowing up the knot. Okay. And I ask that this desingularized central fiber has its even degree cohomology generated by classes of algebraic cycles. Then also X0 tilde admits cohomological decomposition of the diagonal. So once we have this, it's obvious how we get to the theorem A, simply because well, the point is that what I will do is that I consider the.
So it seems like you would take the take the closure which you have on the general fiber. Why do you have this condition about the extra condition?
Curiously, so if I was in the Chao theoretic setting, I don't need
the cohomology.
If I was in the Chao, that would not be a problem. I don't have this assumption. Curiously, when I make the computation purely in cohomology, I have to impose that condition. Maybe it could be weekend. Okay. But in any case, the fact is that I proved that for a trifold, which is, for example, rationally connected, this condition is always satisfied. Okay. So what I am going to do is that I will degenerate the general double solid with k nodes to the Artin-Mumford. So here k be like this to the Artin-Mumford double solid. Just by imposing 10 minus k nodes, one has to show that this can be done. But this is quite easy because, as I said, the parameter space it's a parameter space for quartic K3 surfaces, and the deformation theory of K3 surfaces with nodes is quite easy. It's the period map. It's absolutely no problem to do this. And now, of course, so this one has k nodes, and this one it acquires a few 10 minus k other singularities. And then, of course, so that gives me a family, and I blow up the generic k nodes, and that gives me finally a family like this, where the central fiber will be okay. Where the XB will be the desingularization of double solid with K nodes. And the X0 will be the desingularization of the Artin-Mumford. Double solid. Now, as I just explained, so I know that so this X0 tilde it's a unirational trifold or rationally connected trifold. So I know that it satisfies this assumption. So it's even degree cohomology is algebraic. And but I also know that this is a lemma that I proved. So let me. So I have this assumption satisfied. And on the other hand, I know that the torsion of H3 of X0 tilde Z is non-zero, and by the lemma, the only lemma that I prove, this implies that the X0 tilde does not admit cohomological decomposition of diagonal. So the theorem B implies that that XB does not admit cohomological decomposition of diagonal. Okay, so that proves the result. So I have some time left. So what I would like to explain is that, well, we had for the Artin-Mumford double solid, we had a very concrete cohomological invariant. Which was an obstruction to rationality or stable rationality. Under deformation, this cohomological obstruction has disappeared. That was the main principle. So I would like to show, to explain, in fact, what are the obstructions which are non-trivial by this result, which are contained in this existence or non-existence of a cohomological decomposition of diagonal. So that follows. Uh, Of this non-existence of cohomological decomposition of diagonal. That follows from that is contained in the following result. So I consider an X which again has dimension 3, so in higher dimension is much more difficult to understand. Let X be, so let's assume that it is rationally connected. Okay. Then X admits a cohomological decomposition of diagonal if and only if there are three conditions which appear. So the first condition is that the Artin Mumford invariant is zero. It turns out that because X is rationally connected, this implies that there is no torsion in the cohomology at all. So this is the first condition. The second condition is that I will explain in a minute what this means. There is a universal codimension 2 cycle on G of X cross X. So G of X is the intermediate Jacobian of X, the Griffith intermediate Jacobian. So I'll explain what does that mean, what this means, this universal codimension 2 cycle. And the last condition is that the class theta G minus 1 over G minus 1 factorial is algebraic on G of X. Okay, so there are the three conditions. So this one, of course, I already mentioned. I have to explain what this means. So for this point, the second point here, so it's a result which is due to Bloch and Srinivas. So this refers to the following result of Bloch and Srinivas. They said that if X, for example, is rationally connected, but so this is true, in fact, in any dimension. Maybe the more natural assumption is an assumption on CH0 of X, group of zero cycles. Then the Griffith Bell-Jacobi map, which maps, so it is defined on the group of codimension 2 cycles on X, which are homologous to zero modulo rational equivalent, so the tau 2 of X. So this map it maps naturally to this intermediate Jacobian, G of X, is an isomorphism. So this is a very nice result. And the question which, so this is very similar to the Abel theorem, which says that for any variety, the map from CH1 of X to the G1 of X is a Abel isomorphism. So what this leaves open is the question of the existence of a universal object. The point is that here this group is a kind of abstract group built from cycles, modulo certain equivalence relation. And here it happens to be an algebraic variety. But what we what we would like to have is this. That is here a co-dimension 2 cycle, such that, it's a co-dimension 2 cycle. For each point t in g of x, you get a co-dimension 2 cycle zt in x. So the map phi z from g of x to g of x, which to t associate phi x of the restricted cycle zt, is the identity map. This thing exists for codimension 1 cycles, it's just the Poincaré divisor. But for codimension 2 cycles, a priori, it might not exist. And in fact, we'll see that it does not exist. And as for point 3, here g is the dimension of g of x. It's a fact that I mentioned that g of x. So it's a G-dimensional, principally polarized abelian variety. So it has a theta divisor with class theta in H2 of Z. Then, of course, if you consider theta to the G minus 1, it's certainly the class of a curve. It's an algebraic class on G of X. But this class, in integral cohomology, it is divisible by g minus 1 factorial. And so the question is whether this class, which is obviously a Hodge class, still remains algebraic when we had to make this division. And so there are the objects. And the corollary of this theorem is this. That the corollary of everything, that, for example, the theorem A above, and this theorem, is this. If X is very general, double solid, with seven nodes, exactly. Take the desingularization. Then there is no universal codimension 2 cycle. So that makes a big difference between the theory of codimension 2 cycles and the codimension 1 cycles, the peak zero group, where we always know that, that there is a universal divisor. And the reason is simple, that I know that for this x there is no cohomological decomposition of the diagonal, but I already mentioned that the torsion here, this Artinian found variant vanishes. And this assumption, it is true because I have seven nodes, so the intermediate Jacobian in that case is a dimension 3. So it is a Jacobian of a curve, and then we know that this class is algebraic. So for this x, these two conditions are satisfied, but as it does not admit the cohomological decomposition of the diagonal, this one cannot be satisfied.
Any questions?
Yes.
Well, can I ask two questions? So one is, do you know, is there an example where the theta g of a g factorial is non-algebraic?
No example is none.
It's not known. And then the other question is that universal cycle, rationally, would that be allow rational coefficients?
It exists with rational coefficients. It's simply because, it's simply we know for this variety, it's what say Bloch and Srinivas, that the intermediate Jacobian is parameterized by algebraic cycles. So if for a large enough family of algebraic cycles, you will get a surjective Abel-Jacobi map, and then with Q coefficients, that you will certainly be able to descend this to something in G of X cross X. So what I mean is that certainly on B cross X, So what you are doing, something like this. The Abelian equilibrium is surjective, so you will have your B cross X and a certain codimension 2 cycle here, which give something like surjective. Okay. And then, of course, by cutting B, you can assume that this map is finite. Generically finite. And then you push forward your cycle in B cross X to G of X cross X. But then when you push forward this cycle, somehow the cycle will get multiplied by the degree of the map from B to G of X. So certainly you can construct a cycle directly on G of X cross X, but the result is that the corresponding map here, it will be n times the identity.
So this points in the general position of this intermediate Jacobian just become pure variety, so you do know that they are not rational because of that reason.
So
if the points are not in general position, the dimension of intermediate Jacobian.
No, that's the hope. I mean, the hope is that these criterion they are very unstable under deformations. So I think that the hope will be to prove that rationality or stable rationality is not a deformation invariant property. So I think that.
Let's thank Claire again.